أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه وولاه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، my dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We continue إن شاء الله رب العالمين today with the explanation of this beautiful book of رياض الصالحين by الإمام النووي رحمه الله, and we are with the section of الخوف. Al-Khawf means fear. We explained it, alhamdulillah, last time about the literal meaning of fear and the religious meaning of fear in the aspect or from the angle of your relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal. Our relationship with Allah is the fear that leads you to do two things. Leads you to avoid anything that displeases your Lord, your Master, Allah, your Creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to have a concern to do the things that to get you closer to him. So that type of fear. That type of fear, you are afraid to do, to go this route that he will not be happy with. And you have the concern that I want to be in that route that pleases him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that kind of fear. So we call it concern, you know, better than say it is fear. Because the word fear in English have different connotations than the word khawf in Arabic. Word khawf, it depends. You're afraid of who or what and why. If say I have khawf, the word is like kind of like, okay, you have a concern to something. So yakhafu ala, I have concern for my children. For example, yakhafu ala al-awlad. What are you khawf ala al-awlad? That somebody transgress them. So that's fear. It's not fear from your children to run away from them. No, you are fear for them, you know. So when you say fear, everybody think you're afraid of someone, you run away. No. It is khawf min Allah, يعني من عذاب الله. Why? Because Allah is the only one who have the sifa, attribute, and its opposite. Right? يعني he has severe in the punishment and he has rahmah. Right? Somebody who is severe in punishment, cannot have the rahmah at the same time. As a human, it's either you have rahmah, you have kind of. But Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who can give and take, is the one. So like that, Allah is not in need for anyone. That's why all attributes are His, okay? And He can practice whichever He wants, whenever He wants, with whoever He wants, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why when you say, I'm afraid of Allah, I'm afraid from the aspect of punishment. But I am hopeful at the same time in the aspect of rahmah. And Allah kept both doors open. وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. يعني you choose. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. You have the right to go here. Choice. You have the choice to go here. But I let you know if you go here what happens and if you go here what happens. This pleases me and this pleases me. So what are you afraid of? That side. You know, you're afraid to go here because he explained to you. So you're afraid from the one who warned you that he's displeased, hence will have the punishment. And you are also afraid that you will lose this part. Okay? So you're concerned. So the fear of Allah is more of a concern. Right? Concern that I slip and go here. That will make me repent and come back. And concern that I lose my footing over here. So that's the type of fear we're talking about. I'm concerned to lose my footing. So I said, Ya Allah, thabbitni. ثبتني يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلبي. Keep me firm. That's a concern. So I'm afraid to lose my footing. And you are the only one who will guide me. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. And I'm afraid that I go here or I die while I'm here without repenting. That's it. So you are not actually afraid from Allah himself. You are afraid from what he can do. سبحانه وتعالى. So you are begging him and making dua. So that's the concept of fear in Islam. I don't want to get into the philosophical aspects of it, but that's, I think, enough to get the idea of what fear is. Now, we have another concept, which is called khashya. Khashya also will be translated as fear. If you go in any translation, you will find khawf and khashya, the fear, but they are different. Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned khashya in Quran. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Khashya is with knowledge. You know why you're afraid. So some people, khawf only is the concept of fear, as I told you. Any lay person, he is afraid of the adab of Allah. Right? But khashya, you are also afraid of the adab of Allah, but you know who's Allah. قدر of Allah, the صفات of Allah, the creation of Allah. So your relationship with Allah is based on knowledge. It's not based on culture. It's not based on mass worship. You know, people see, people do. Like they see each other, like a child sees his father praying, he started doing it, he doesn't know what is that. And when he grows, he knows his salah, but he's doing it anyways. For that aspect develops khawf. Khawf makes you away from that and makes you stable in that. But khashya, you know the process. It's like you are good with computers, but there is a hardware engineer who's also good with computers. But when he's dealing with computer, he knows what is doing what. Correct? So two people are using the computer and they're skilled in using the things. But the hardware engineer knows what makes this happen. And when he hears the sound, he knows the fan is this and that, and it's like a mechanic. But you drive the car and the mechanic drives the car. Maybe actually can drive the car better than the mechanic. But when the mechanic sees, he sees what enables the car to go like this. So he's more aware of the maintenance. He's more aware of the dynamic. He's better than you to figure out a problem before it comes. Right? But you can drive the car and make donuts and do whatever, all of those kind of things. Great. But before you go, you do not know. But the mechanic, once he starts the car, there are 5-6 things come in his head. And when, you know, put the brakes on and he does this and he does that, then you say, no, you cannot make the donuts today. The car has an issue. هذا الخشية. خوف not necessarily will make you go in the process, thought process before. It will make you black and white. You know, like I do this, I don't do that. هذا خوف. خوف leads majority of the people to do or not to do. But الخشية, you know whom you are dealing with. You know whom you're dealing with. فيعني people disobey because they do not know the status of the one they are disobeying. They look at the sin, small or big. But the Muslim, I mean the real believer, khashya, the alim, he looks to the one he is making the sin against him. That's why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, the munafiq, I mean the believer, whenever the sin, small or big, he feels like a mountain behind him is going to crumble over his head. And the munafiq feels the major sin comes like a fly in front of his nose. He does like this. So here, what is the difference that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud saying? The second one looks at the physical, actual sin. Is big or small? And when he says it's big, yeah, it's okay. Allah forgive. So who's Allah who will forgive? Who's that one? And if you know that Allah is so big to forgive, you should have known that He is so big to disobey. So this is the idea. So Imam Shafi'i said, do not look how small is the sin, look how big is Allah, the one you're going to disobey. If you do that, then the sin is not an issue, small or big. Actually, the bigger it is, the scarier it is going to become. And the smaller it is, you're still scared because you know how big is Allah Azza wa Jalla and His ability. Same thing. Alhamdulillah. When you deal with your direct manager or boss, it's different from when you deal with the CEO of the company. That he's going to come down on you. So the bigger the... Now you know it's a big trouble. Like in the team, when they say the manager is coming, it's different reaction when you say the district guy is coming to check this team. So everybody now is like, what's going to happen? So it's beyond our manager now. Our manager can talk to him, whatever, what's happening, this, there are layoffs, whatever. We can cancel the whole team. Huh? So, you know, why is that visit? And everybody's like, what makes that different? His value, his ability, his decision-making ability is what made you concerned. هذه الخشية. That's exactly what خشية is. You are afraid for a reason. But خوف, you're just afraid, right? Allah is big. He has nar, he has jannah. I want jannah and even khawf had. But khashya is the process. I am going to commit that sin, but I know Allah Azza wa Jal wiped nations for small sins, for this sin, for that sin. He warned it. Allah is Rahim, but His adab is severe. I'm not safe from it. So that's khashya. And that's why Allah said, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. So not everybody has khashya. He said, مِنْ عِبَادِهِ. Out of his servants, there are only few people who have khashya. So not everybody has khashya. And Allah will not punish people if they don't have khashya. But having khashya gets you in a better footing. So that's why we tell people always learn. Asma Allah al-Husna, the sifat of Allah. Read the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The history of the sahaba, the tabi'een. Read in that. That's why I was telling a group of students I'm coaching every Saturday morning. They are like actually, يعني sheikhs. They are da'is and the sheikhs. They have يعني classes and all that. But I'm doing like an advanced coaching for them to teach advanced texts, classical texts, you know. So I was telling them that I found that one of the main reasons that gives me the passion to teach and be concerned about the coming generation is reading about the history of Islam. Mm. So reading the biographies of people who existed. And not one, not two, like read a thousand. Like read as much, and I'm serious about this one. The more you read, the more you will know the hikmah and the cause of what you're doing. Because you relate to somebody for sure 100% in different aspects in your life. Somebody who you have kids, some of them will have kids and how they managed. A spouse, good spouse, many of them have good spouses and how that affected. Not good spouse, many of them also have not good spouses and how did... So you will relate in all aspects no matter what. But you have to read in a vast... So bring it from... Not... يعني prophets is okay, but start from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I tell people to go and see the environment which was there at the time of the birth of the Prophet. You will know that he did not come just like that. No, he came as a result of many things happening in Persia and Rome and this and that and that. So that time needed a prophet. And that prophet needed to be prepared over 40 years. That's the point I'm trying to make, because we overlook these things, right? We jump from the birth to 40. But in that 40 years, what was the traits of Prophet Muhammad and the traits of the people around? Yani there was someone who was able not to worship the mass culture worship. He never prostrated to, and he was not alone. Abu Bakr didn't either. So there was a group of people who were raised in houses that has freedom not to worship with their parents. That's the part I wanted to emphasize on. Mm-hmm. Yani they were in Jahiliyyah and all of that. He never drank. He never committed fahisha. Yani people used to go and do all this. Prostitutes were open. Yani they have red flags that this is where the prostitution house. But they didn't do it. Mm-hmm. He didn't deal in the riba. And there were people who believe in the deen of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And they were never opposed. So why is Prophet Muhammad opposed? Those are the things I want you to see. Yani we have to look at the seerah, ya akhwani, in a way that developed this khashya, not the khawf. Huh? That look at the seerah and look at those things deeply. Not keep repeating the story without any meaning. Yani there was people who... There were 5-6 people who followed the deen of Sayyidina Ibrahim, and they were preaching in front of the Kaaba, telling them, this is haram. You cannot make zabiha to other than Allah. And they were saying that, but they never opposed them. Huh? But when Prophet Muhammad, became a prophet, nobody opposed him, and nobody actually cared. When did they care? When he stood up in front of the Kaaba and said, now I am the prophet of God, you have to follow me. Now, so what is that hairline that differed from him? You can do whatever, okay, and not okay. That answer will show you what we're doing now. So what is the answer? If religion is your personal thing, you're fine. Now, if you want it to become a society deal, that's not fine. Okay? And now if you want to rule everything and develop a way of life, now you're not fine. So you have to know that as long as people agreeing with you, there is something wrong. When you start seeing resistance, means you are on the right path. You have to. So sometimes you don't have resistance. Why? Because you are dealing with 3-4 people. Try 30. Try 300. Huh? Try to go out and say, we need to make the change in this community. We need to bring our children to the... Now we have resistance. Ya akhi, children, they are under pressure, blah, blah, blah. Leave them alone. Do basketball. I don't want lectures. You know, you will find many opinions now coming. Why? Because your circle is getting bigger. And that's why people are afraid, khawf, from your da'wah. So you have to develop a smaller group around you who have khashiyah. Okay? Then you are not alone. And that's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, see now the magic, listen to this. That's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose this group, and they were going under persecution and everything, but he was telling them, hold on, hold on. The stronger you are, the more resistant you are, you're defeating them inside. And that's why they were like, why Prophet Muhammad did not make dua and Bilal is like free? Mm-hmm. No, it was intentional that he has to stay under this. It sounds gruesome from outside, right? But it's for his own good and for the Ummah's own good for thousands of years to come. So the Prophet said that. But Prophet would not accept any of them to be persecuted when they're on Medina, correct? Nobody can touch a Muslim. Mm-hmm. A nail of a child will wage a war. Why? Because now the concept changed. So these people sacrificed intentionally. Why? Because they punish and they punish and they punish, and there was no, they could not subjugate them. So now the punisher is weak. If I kill Bilal, I'm defeated. He reached to that level, you know? If I kill this guy, why they keep punishing? Yani killing a slave for them was easier than killing an animal, you know? So why they did not kill Bilal? You get the idea? And the Prophet not wanted that to continue, but as in the bigger picture, as we were talking, you know, seeing the bigger picture, he is tearing apart from inside, you know, seeing him like this. But Allah said, leave him. He is actually the one punishing them. They are punishing his body. And Bilal, who is Bilal after for the rest of his life? A huge deal. You know? And everyone who become Muslim said, oh, this is Bilal. It's like the kids now looking at a basketball player. You know, I saw him now in front of me. Hada Bilal. Jihad Bilal, the jihad of Bilal, was defeating everyone, punishing him. He was doing the opposite. But that's what Makki period did. So I want people to read the seerah with that mindset. Okay? So relate. It's not only story and Bilal and the big stone and all that. But what is the psychology of that? You read and he will tell you Bilal. He said, why I used to say Ahadun Ahad? Why? Umar ibn al-Khattab asked him later when he's Amir al-Mu'mineen, why you kept saying that word? She's bothered Umar all this time. Why? He told him, I tried different words. Right? And I found this, that it irritates them the most. You see, he was fighting. He was not being punished. He was fighting back. So he was enjoying it. So if you are under severe punishment and you know if you say a word, it irritates them, so they punish you more. Said, okay, I'm not going to say it again. Right? But that's the regular guy. But he was fighting back. So that is my power now. I am defeating you. You are not defeating me. So people will beat until he's tired. Then another guy comes. And that guy who's tired, looking at Bilal, and Bilal tell him, I won. One of you cannot do it. You know, I won. So that is the Muslim. Sometimes you look at the defeat when somebody tell you a word that irritates you. Or somebody pushed you away. You go away. La. Be Bilal. If you have a cause and you have a prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you have the Quran, you stand there. Change your attitude. Like Bilal changed the words, right? Change your attitude. Change their approach. But win the battle at the end. And when somebody resists you, you know that they are getting defeated. Otherwise, they will not resist you. That's why I said, you know, he's just, you know. But if they know you are impactful, people start coming around you, they will start resisting you even more. هذا خوف يا أخواني. خوف. But خشية, you will not be afraid except for a reason. I'll be afraid of you if your opinion is going to actually affect me negatively. But if it is positive, أهلاً وسهلاً, I'll support you. Right? So خشية is being afraid of the right thing for the right reason. And you know the thought process. But خوف is just afraid. فهذا معنى الخوف. طب حديث عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه that we will take today. It's a beautiful hadith, ما شاء الله. All the hadith beautiful, but this hadith is one of the hadith that they said it is one quarter of the deen. حديث one quarter of the deen. So عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال حدثنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو الصادق المصدوق. See the description he put there. عبد الله بن مسعود is not any صحابي يعني. It's a senior, and if he adds a word, that means it makes a difference. We know that Rasulullah is a sadiq al mazduq. We do, صح? We do a sadiq al mazduq. I mean, حدثنا رسول الله is enough. But why he said وهو الصادق المصدوق, and he is truly the truthful and the one that everybody believes in, like مصدوق يعني everything he says should be believed. Because what is going to come is ghaib. What Rasulullah is going to talk about is ghaib. And people will come and always dispute the things which is metaphysical, ghaib. Yeah. So Abdullah bin Mas'ud has to put someone to shut anybody who denies before even he speaks. Yani whatever coming, take it. Because your mind is going to play tricks on you. So he said, وَهُوَ الصَّادِقُ المصدوق. I'm giving you like if I, before I speak, I said, you know, I have a good brother for you and he's a very trustworthy person. He's exactly like me. So now what I did, any doubts that you will have, I eliminated already. Because me and you have a certain relationship. So I'm telling you like, if that person you talk to, as if you are talking to me. So now I eliminated anything. So if that person starts saying strange things for you, said, the sheikh already give the, right? So Abdullah bin Mas'ud is saying that in the beginning. Very smart. He said, وَهُوَ الصَّادِقُ الْمَصْدُوقُ. Everybody knows that. But now, I don't want any doubt even to come to your head about what's going to be said. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, إِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ يُجْمَعُ خَلْقُهُ فِي بَطْنِ أُمِّهِ 40 يَوْمًا نُطْفَةً. One of you would be in the womb of his mother 40 days as nutfa. Nutfa يعني sperm, semen, with the ovum. So that's nutfa, called the nutfa. Nutfa from the man. Okay? Then he said 40 days. For them, this was, how do they know? There was no يعني, ultrasound, there was no medicine, nothing like that. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam telling them, each one of you, 40 days you stayed as nutfa in your mother's womb. ثم يكون علاقة مثل ذلك. He becomes علاقة, يعني the hanging clot of blood, 40 days also. So that's 80 now. ثُمَّ يَكُونُ مُضْغَةً مِثْلَ ذَلِكَ. Then mudgha, the flesh, يعني the morsel of the flesh. It's like a shrimp or something like that, they said. مِثْلُ ذَلِكَ. So 120 days, يعني 4 months. ثُمَّ يُرْسَلُ الْمَلَكَ. The angel will be sent. فينفخ فيه الروح. He will give the روح in him. How? Allah knows. ويؤمر بأربع كلمات. يعني the angel will be ordered with 4 things. كلمات يعني word, but it means things as well in Arabic. بكتب رزقه. Write the rizq of the child. يعني رزق until he dies. How much he's gonna make. So you have a number and I have a number. Everybody have a number, you know. How much you making? Rizq. وَأَجَلِهِ. When, how long you live? وَعَمَلِهِ. What you gonna do? وَشَقِيٌ أَوْ سَعِيدٌ. That's a mushkil part. يعني. He's good, he's shaqi or sa'id in this life. فَوَالَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ غَيْرُهُ. By the one that there is no one worthy of worship but him. إن أحدكم لا يعمل بعمل أهل الجنة. One of you will work with the people, the work of the people of Jannah. حتى ما يكون بينه وبينها إلا ذراع. Only one arm span. فيسبق عليه الكتاب فيعمل بعمل أهل النار. Then the destiny will change and he will work with the people of hellfire and he enters it. See, that's the خشية, that's the خوف. See, the khashya now is like you know why. So you're afraid until you die. It's not like, okay, now I'm 60, yeah. I'm good. There is no such a thing. فَيَسْبِقُ عَلَيْهِ الْكِتَابِ And the other person will work with the bad people's job. The people who qualify for hellfire. Until he's only having an arm span. And then he will do the people of Jannah. And then he will enter the Jannah. طيب, this hadith, people will think that, what is this? يعني, I don't have a choice. No, you do. Because you don't know. يعني, always people get to that corner, right? So what is the point? يعني, if I'm destined. طيب, the point is, do you know you're destined for Jannah or hell? Then your only choice is to keep the hope. Keep the hope. And you do not know what is written in the book. And Allah Azza wa Jalla is beyond the time and space and physical things. And so you are already thinking that it is written in the book, yani past. And where I'm going to go is future. But Allah is above all of that. Yani if you go to another planet in the Milky Way, do you think your calculation of time will be the same? Huh? Your weight is not the same. Your diet is not the same. Your whole being is not the same. Okay? So imagine Allah, the creator of all of this. What is the concept of time for him? So don't treat Allah as if he's living with you on earth. And that's what I tell people always about this issue of qada and qadar. Your problem is you think Allah lives in earth in a big castle, you know, sitting there. How come you already decided and, you know, it's coming in the future? No. Even people now have a concept called the Mandela effect. I don't know if you heard about Mandela effect or not. No, you didn't hear it? Okay. And this is true, by the way. I myself, you know, experienced that. Mandela effect is, in a summary, and I'm trying to use it for a point here, yani, for Allah's Qadr. Yani. Mandela's effect, they're saying that sometimes you perceive things in a certain way physically. Like it smelled in a certain way or looked in a certain way. Let's say like, you saw with your eyes all your life thinking that something is like that, but it was never like that. So some people, when they were asked about emojis, you know the emojis, the yellow thing, like draw an emoji that different from all emojis. So they draw two or three emojis that they never existed actually. Mm-hmm. And they thought that they see them daily. Right? Some people like see, as they say, when I go to London, there is a certain restaurant in that corner. But when they go to London, it never existed. And it's not one guy. Like some people are overloaded. There is a website, yeah. Mm-hmm. Like more than one person agree on that. Mm-hmm. There is a restaurant in that corner. But that's called Mandela effect. Yeah. I mean, that's the summary of it. So they are saying, there are theories now. They are saying like somebody have access to go to the past and change something little, mm-hmm. So it's wiped out from the memory of humanity. That's a theory. Mm-hmm. But again, when you go back to Allah Azza wa Jal, there is no past, present, and future. If he's the creator of past, present, future, he cannot be under their rule, yani, under that rule of past, present, and future. And we proved now that as a human going to space, everything changes because there is no sun and the moon. There is no day and night. Hence, there is no week and month. Hence, there is no year. Hence, there is no concept of time. Yeah. And if you go in a certain speed in physics, that you kind of break the barrier of time. And that's what happened to the Prophet in Isra and Mi'raj. He sees things happening in the future, but they are not here yet. You get the idea now, right? So imagine if Allah Azza wa Jal, yani when we say Qada and Qadr, I want you to understand it like that. Like Qada and Qadr is made by Allah, that the concept of time only applies to me, but doesn't apply to him. The concept of space applies to me, but doesn't apply to him. So I have to look to that as a mercy. That means anything can change. Right? Anything can change. Allah is able to change. Yes or no? If you can, if you say that Allah is not going to change he will change. When doesn't apply to him? I don't want you to be alhamdulillah confused. Sometimes a complicated concept help you to be at ease. Because we, our problem is that we try to simplify any complicated things, but some things meant to be complicated. So you say, okay, I'll deal with it as it is, you know, like that. Not everybody wants to figure the mechanism of the watch. I just want to look at the watch and I'm fine. But if I go figure it out, then what's going to happen? I'll break it apart. And then I don't have a watch to know the time. So what I'm concerned now, I just know the time. Mechanism, I give it to the guy who does. When he looks at it, he figures it out. So when you're dealing with Allah Azza wa Jal, I want you to deal as simple as that. Yani, what are you required to do? Why are you buying a watch? To figure the mechanism or to know the time? To know the time. Stick there, akhi. Stay there. Fa, yani, that is the idea of khawf. And Khashyaf Abdullah bin Mas'ud saying that 40 days nutfa, 40 days alaqa, 40 days mudgha, and then after 4 months, the soul is done. That's why the fuqaha said that abortion, for example, if there is a reason for it, it's okay within the that period of time, but not after. So they divided it. 40 days, the first 40 days, because some of the, now the scientists and all of that, they come and say, but this cell is alive. Not the ruh life,
right,
but it is alive. Like the tree is alive, like this alive, there is a cell which is alive. So there is a form of life to another form of life later, right?
Mm-hmm.
But there's a form of life, and this is the debate. So after 40 days, yani within the first 40 days, they say that can happen without reason. Just can happen without a reason. Then the mother or the father will not be accounted as killing the first 40 days. Sometimes there is rape. Sometimes there is an issue. Sometimes the genetics or whatever it is, and the pregnancy happened without being ready for it. For some people, they give valid reasons because we don't want to encourage it just.
Right.
Yeah, because we're encouraging it with the system of Islam, not for the teenagers and not for the people who go and they have the haram relationship, and we say, yeah, you can do it and do the abortion. That's never the case. Yani. But we are talking within the marriage system, right? That two people married, because in our religion, pregnancy will happen only between, for a woman who is married.
Mm-hmm.
So we are not encouraging this out of that. Okay, for we're talking about a system here. So 40 days, the reason is not going to be, the reason will not lead to accountability. And whatever reason, and the abortion happened, and better to have a reason, there is no accountability on that. That's why it's a fiqhi classification more than anything else. Is it encouraged? No. Right? Once you get pregnant, alhamdulillah, you know, that's from Allah. Allah is the one who gives rizq and all of that. But if there is a valid psychological, physical, social reason, some problem, you know, then, yeah, you know, you have a sick child that they take care of, and then the wife got pregnant right now. It's an issue, yeah. So we give the fatwa, it's all right, 40 days. Type. From day 41 until 4 months, there have to be another set of reasons, not only an optional thing yani, now, right? So the scholar said that as well. Some of the scholars said all the 4 months is the same like the 40 days. So some said 40 days only, and after 40 days you have to have a reason that is threatening,
stronger reason.
Stronger reason would be like the doctors say that after testing, this child will come with a defect. This child come with a problem.
Mm-hmm.
So it can be like that is the reason
to
abort. Like harm to the mother is after the four months.
Mm-hmm.
Harm to the mother, of course, it bypasses everything. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So if there is a harm to the mother, then you save the mother. She'll get pregnant again later. She will find the issues later. We'll deal with it later. But if you sacrifice the mother for the child, that's not the... that who's not even formed yet.
Mm-hmm.
يعني they say that after 4 months, even if the results, the tests show that the child will have a defect or a mental problem or this, you cannot abort after 4 months. Once the ruh comes, means his fate is sealed like this. So you cannot abort that because you are killing someone that has the nafs written, everything written, and he has a ruh. يعني this ruh is assigned to him, came to him. Before the ruh, there is an area of negotiation, right? It's a life cell, yes. But there is no ruh, and malak did not write according to this hadith. See, that's why they say this hadith is one quarter of the deen, because many things build on it. believe in the qadar, believe in the khalq, believe in the unseen miracle of the sunnah, that you know all the fetus things, the stages that came later on, how to believe in Allah Azza wa Jal, how the qadr should make you work harder, not become submissive, not become indifferent. And there are many things in that hadith that will develop your character in the aqidah aspect. Then the other quarter is إنما الأعمال بالنيات وإنما لكل امرئ ما نوى. So that is the second quarter, and under it comes the niyyah and the amal and all of that. Then the third quarter, الحلال بين والحرام بين وبينهما مشتبهات. You know, and that comes now under it is everything basically. And the fourth one is حديث سيدة عائشة رضي الله عنها that من عمل من أمرنا هذا ما ليس فيه فهو عليه رد. Whoever innovated our affair that what is not from it, it will go back to him. And that comes in the like the fine tuning of everything. You have to make sure it is in accordance to the Quran and the Sunnah. So each hadith handles one aspect, so it gives you like a 4D of the deen. Yeah, those are four hadith that the Imam said whoever knows those four hadith and act according to them will be saved in most of the things. So I think there can be a khutbah, yani.
Yeah.
Yeah, four hadith. Remember them very well. Hadith famous, إنما الأعمال بالنيات. That's very famous hadith. Then the hadith about halal and haram. They are clear. So those are easy to remember. Remember them in that order, you know. Hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the creation of man. Let's that hadith be number one. 40, 40, 40, then everything is sealed. So that's number one before you are even born. Once you are born and you become mukallaf, then the niyyah is important. Right? Then after your niyyah worked out, then you need to know what is right and what is wrong. Halal and haram and the gray area. Then after that, you cannot innovate in the religion. Otherwise, you'll be accounted for it. So, creation, niyyah, halal and haram, and bid'ah. So, four covers your religion. So, if you are, those four are in your head, those are the standard or the main gauge for, I mean, you know, judging everything you do. You know, do I believe in Allah Azza wa Jal that He sealed everything in Qadr and all that? Then it will help you with everything coming your way. Is my niyyah sincere about everything I do? This will help you with clarifying your heart. Then once you start going, there is halal and haram, and I need to be saved from that. And then, you know, I'm going to work according only to what I'm given. I'm not going to innovate in the religion. Subhanallah, you sit. We understand that we are not safe until we meet Allah Azza wa Jal. You are not safe until you enter your grave. So that's why Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, when somebody told him, why you keep learning and you are holding the, this ink. I want to show so people can get an idea. This is how they used to write. So they are carrying mihbara والقلم يعني. قلم والدواء. So they... And then they write on the leather and the things. So that's how they use. طبعاً, this is a very thick tip, but they have it thinner and thicker based on what the font they want to do. But I can go, you know, this way, so it becomes thin, and I can go this way, it becomes thick. You know, so there is a certain font if you do this, and there is a certain font if you do this. And sometimes you start here and go like this. Sometimes you start here and go like this. It depends, yani. So this is for writing calligraphy and things like that. So, and that's why they used to see Imam Ahmed always having this. So they said, yeah, Imam, you are the Imam Ahmed. Yani people follow you with this. Why you are carrying it? قَالَ مَعَ الْمِحْبَرَةِ إِلَى الْمَقْبَرَةِ. مَحْبَرَة is this. مَقْبَرَة is the grave. Grave. He said, I am with مِحْبَرَة until I get to Maqbara. But that's what I wanted everybody to have the picture of. Like, I am learning until I go to the grave. Why I'm learning? Because I'm afraid. I'm afraid that there is something out there I can learn that it can save me. And I want to leave everybody with this today. There is something out there that if I learn, it will save me from Adabullah. So why I sit home and sleep? That is khawf. That is khashya, I mean. That they have a reason. Wake up in the morning, there has to be something out there that I don't know, for sure. And maybe that thing is what is going to save me, subhanAllah, from عذاب of Allah and get me al-firdaus al-a'la. Because I might die while I'm doing it. I might die today while I'm seeking that knowledge. You read in the history of the Imams, back to my point, read in the history of the Imams, you will know these things. That how Imam Abu Yusuf, for example, student of Imam Abu Hanifa, when he was in his deathbed, he's Qadir Qudha, Imam Yusuf, big deal in the world at his time. And when he's dying, somebody may ask him a mas'ala that he was never asked before. In his deathbed, and he died the next day. So he sat up and he said, bring the mahbara and the pen, write it down. He said, yeah, Imam, you're dying. He said, no, if I meet Allah with one extra mas'ala that I try to solve, it's better than I meet him with one less. But you get the idea that maybe when I give fatwa in this, this is what seals the deal. And actually it was. The last mas'ala he was asked and he died the next morning. So maybe answering that mas'ala in that state is what gets him to Jannah and nothing before counts. هَذَا بَعَى الْخَشْيَةِ That is what we call khashya from Allah Azza wa Jal, that you are concerned to the last breath that there is something out there. If I do, this might be my ticket to Jannah. For why I stay? Because all what I did may not count. So always, as a Muslim, have that khawf from Allah that become an incentive that there is something out there I need to learn and might be my reason to go to Jannah, and that's the khashya of Allah. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give us his khashya, subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم وجزاكم الله خيرا والحمد لله رب العالمين.